So, there's a new top of the range Audi in town, except right now it's not in town. As you can see, it's in the wilderness of the Chilean Atacama Desert, which is where Audi has chosen to launch the new Q8 luxury SUV, as you do. Now, do not adjust your seats. You have not watched a first drive review video on this car before, although you might think you have. Believe it or not, this is the sixth large SUV from the Elephantine Volkswagen Group on the same MLB Evo platform to be launched in the last 3 years. It follows the Q7 sister car, but also the Bentley Bentayga, the Volkswagen Touareg, Porsche Cayenne, and the Lamborghini Urus. The Q8 isn't like a lot of those other SUVs because it's sort of half SUV, half four-door grand touring coupe. So it's got frameless doors and a low roof line and big features and flared arches. And it's trying to look a bit more desirable than the average big family car. From some angles, you will have noticed it does look quite a lot like a Lamborghini Urus. And interestingly, if you talk to Audi's designers about that car, they'll tell you that it was the Q8 project that started first and the Lamborghini that piggybacked on their efforts. So without the Q8, there would be no Urus. Or maybe that's just what they want us to believe. But the car is wider, slightly lower to the ground, and shorter overall than the Q7 sister car on which it's based. It launches in the UK later this summer with only one engine, the 3-litre 50 TDI, which will be a mild hybrid diesel. There will be a less powerful diesel and a more powerful petrol coming next year. You get lots and lots of active chassis technology with the car, either a standard or as an option. So there's proper centre diff-paced four-wheel drive and adaptive sport-tuned air suspension as standard. If you move up to the higher end Vorsprung trim, you also get four-wheel steering and just about every active safety system known to man. Prices for the sort of mid-range diesel are going to start at about 65,000, moving up to just north of 80,000 for the car with all the bells and whistles. And that's actually a lot of money, but it's pretty competitive when you look at like-for-like examples of the Range Rover Velar, the BMW X6, the Maserati Levante. There is no like-for-like Porsche Cayenne anymore because Porsche no longer makes diesels. But there you go. That's just the crazy world we live in. Inside the car, the Q8 sort of picks up where Audi's latest big saloons, A6, A7, A8, left off. Very leathery and chromey, very high-end, very expensive feeling. The infotainment setup sort of dominates the driving environment. There are a couple of touchscreens, one above the other, one slightly bigger than the other. They're pretty imposing, but they're actually pretty easy to use, and they certainly look pretty sophisticated. Along with those, you obviously get Audi's virtual cockpit display. So between the three, at times it is more like you're flying some kind of low-level private jet than driving a car. It's all very high-tech. So to drive, the car is fairly sporty. It's got plenty of performance. It's just not quite up there at the level of your Range Rover Sport SVR or your Cayenne Turbo or even sort of a high-end Range Rover Velar for sort of driver involvement and performance level. It's just not quite been allowed to hit that mark yet, I suspect. That's mostly to do with engine range. So there's no V8 petrol turbo option for now. So the performance level of the car and its sort of handling appeal, it's not quite up there with your Porsche Cayenne Turbos or your Range Rover Sport SVRs. Having said that, the car's good at what it does. It's got a nice broad range of dynamic ability, so it can be comfy at one moment and then fast and agile enough the next moment. And it's a big luxury Audi. It's at the moment it's not really aiming to take on the Cayenne Turbos and the Range Rover SVRs of this world, fair enough. But there is just this lingering suggestion for the moment of unfulfilled potential about this car. You know, if Audi wanted to make a really big statement with an all-new flagship vehicle, which is effectively what this car is, I think it could have just dialed the design up a little bit more. It could have given us that real flagship version of the car from the get-go, and we might have all been standing here sort of saying, wow, I never expected that. As it is, the car is a desirable, you know, luxury SUV, but I'm not sure you look at it and you're amazed by it. I'm not sure it's quite up there from a sort of a styling appeal on the level of a Range Rover Velar, and it's certainly not up there with a, you know, with a Cayenne turbo for driver appeal. But who knows? Maybe it will get there. We will watch with interest.